Hello everybody, today we're going to talk about Ldap. It stands for Lightweight Directory Access Protocol. The idea is basically that we use a centralized service in order to authenticate and log into a computer. We use this at the university and lots of companies around the world actually use it. What it is you create an Ldap server and then all of your computers are essentially Ldap clients. So they have been configured so that every time some user tries to log in, they can basically contact the Ldap server and authenticate against a list of users and their passwords. Of course, it can be used for other components, not just user authentication. You can set directories, you can do lots of other information. It helps simplify the infrastructure and the organization of any network. What we will be doing today is we'll start with a simple account creation and create a user so that you can log into it. Your server will be Prometheus and your client will be a virtual machine, which will be vPrometheus 0. That will either be the virtual machine that you have successfully kickstarted, or if you haven't, you can go to Moodle. The link is in the methodology on the first page of the lab sheet, and you can actually download a vPrometheus 0 that it is the one that I kickstarted myself, actually, so I just shared it with you on my Google Drive. So, some information before we start. We need to make sure that we have the correct infrastructure in place. So, for example, in the labsheet, I'm setting up the IP addresses and the computer names for everything that I need. So I'm going to have Prometheus, that's going to be my LDAP server, with an IP address of 192.168.137.1. And I'm going to have vPrometheus 0, which is going to be my client, with 192.168.137.2. This is because if I go to Prometheus and type ifconfig, I have an ENS33 which has an IP address of 192.168.40.132. So I'm using Prometheus in a NATed environment on my Windows host. So this is what my NAT from VMware DHCP server gave me. But this is from the Kickstarter infrastructure that we used in the previous labsheet. This VMNet 1 and VMNet 8 exist here already, and this is essentially what happens if you just install VMware Player anywhere. So you get host only and you get an added environment as well. So my VMware inside VMware installation has started up VMNet 1 with an IP address of 192.168.137.1. Going on to vPrometheus 0, my client, you'll see that ENS33 has 192.168.137.2, which is of course because I have set the settings of this virtual machine to be host only, which is what I wanted to be to connect to the host. So as soon as you start up the virtual machine, vPrometheus 0, you should be able to ping whatever IP address your VMNet 1 has here. So you should be able to 192.168.137.1. Okay. What extra thing we need to do for this is we need to make sure that your network works, and we need to make sure that you can ping by computer name, so not just by IP address. The first thing that I would like you to do is type IP tables minus F. So IP tables minus F will clear the firewall rules. So if I type minus L to list the current firewall rules, you see that my firewall is on and there are some rules in the tables there. So if I type minus F and then minus L again, you'll see that it's all now cleared. All right, so don't forget IP tables minus F on the host. Do it on the virtual machine as well, just to be safe. So IP tables minus F in here as well should clear the tables on both machines that you're using. So, what else do you need? In order to be able to ping by name, your host's file needs to know about it. Usually we'd use DNS, but because we don't want to go into the hassle of setting all of this up, of course if you are using it in a company, there will be a valid DNS server, so you just need to point to that and this should work already. So just for our test environment here, we need to go to our etc. hosts on the host and on the virtual machine, so both on Prometheus and vPrometheus 0, and make sure that they both look like this. So if I cut etc. Hosts. I have my default localhost statements on top, and then I have my virtual machines on two lines, and this should be exactly the same on my virtual machine as well. Okay, so now I know that I should be able to ping each other by name. So I should be able to ping Prometheus. And of course I can. Right, and I should be able to ping vPrometheus from my host as well. So with that out of the way, we can actually start on the actual LDAP work. So we start with the software installation. All you need is you can copy and paste all of this command. I have done this, so this system is configured already. The reason for this is that there are some very long configuration files afterwards, and I didn't want to waste time doing that. The one thing I would ask you to be careful about is if you do copy and paste the command here from the PDF, even though I've tried to sanitize the PDF so that all of the minuses and all the dashes are actually what they appear to be, you still might get some errors copying from one to the other, so copying from the PDF into the virtual machine. So if you do type a command and it doesn't work, you get something, if you copy a command, sorry, and you get something weird, it doesn't work, gives you an error, type it by hand and it will work. Okay, so yum-y install all the packages we need, and then we start the service, which is called slapd, and then we enable it so that it starts every time when you boot up your computer automatically, and then we can basically check that the service is actually running. So I can copy and paste this, let's see. Okay, so the service is running, it's listening on port 389, which is the default port for LDAP. Okay, and it has some connections established already as well. So the next thing we need to do is we set up the LDAP admin password. You're setting up an authentication server. The best thing that you need to do is have an admin password for it. We're going to set it up as localhost 1. Okay, so you just run this command in a terminal, and then you will get an output that looks like this. You're going to need this. Okay, and of course this is not going to be the same for everybody. This will be unique to each computer. So what I recommend is you can either continue working on the same terminal and copy and paste this onto a text file, or you can just press Shift Control T, open a new tab essentially, and work in another tab on the same terminal. This way you will keep this password alive so that you can copy and paste it into the configuration file that we'll do later, that we'll create later on. Alright, so it's up to you really. So now that we have installed it, we have configured an admin account with this password, we need to configure the LDAP server itself. So we need to create some entities into it. Now, OpenLDAP server configuration files are found in etc. OpenLDAP slap.d. And to start with the configuration of LDAP, we need to update some of the variables in there, most importantly the suffix and the root DN. So the suffix is a database suffix, it is a domain name for which the LDAP server provides the information. In simple words, it should be changed to your domain name. In our case, our domain name is netlab.e.port.ac.uk. Okay, so this is the suffix of your computer name, this is the prefix of your computer name. Sorry, this is the prefix of the computer name. So we need to make sure that your LDAP server is configured for the specific suffix. Root DN, root distinguished name, is the entry for the user who has the unrestricted access to perform all administration activities on LDAP, like a root user. So we have the admin user, we'll create another user as well. And the root password is, of course, the LDAP admin password for the above root DN. What we do is we create files that are .ldif files. Alright, so as you are sitting in your current home directory, okay, you don't need to go, and you shouldn't really go to etc. openldap slap.d to create those files, because we will create this with an editor and then we will modify the LDAP server by using a command such as this, LDAP modify. Alright, it's better to create the files and then add the information properly, rather than just try to edit the files themselves. In most cases it won't work anyway. So if I type ls in my current working directory, you'll see that I already have some LDIFs. Yes, I have a Fred LDIF, Last LDIF, these are users. I have Monitor LDIF, Base, and DB. So our job is to create the DB, the Base, the Monitor, and the VAS LDIF as we move along. So the DB LDIF needs to have the entries below. So all of this needs to be here. You can copy and paste it up to here, create a text file, and essentially you can use VI to do this, or you can use gedit if you like, if you feel more comfortable using that, you don't want to work in a terminal. So once you do that, I can show you my LDIF file. So VI db.ldif. So mine looks like this. Okay, DC is netlab port UK, so that's the domain that we're using. We have our root DN, which is LDAP ADM, and we have the password for that user as well. And the password is whatever came up on my password command. So it is whatever came up for me when I type slap passwd localhost 1. Alright, so you create this file and you then run the command ldap modify minus y external and so on. It should just create a couple of entries and you just say yes, that's done, no problem. If you get any problems, any errors, so make sure you read the output of this command, it means that you have a typo. There can't be anything else. If you've installed LDAP already successfully, then you have a typo. The typo could be, even though I've, you know, if you've copy and pasted it from this PDF file, and I have tried to clear it, so I after I created the PDF file, I went and pressed enter at the end of each line, so there shouldn't really be any spaces or any control characters in here, but we never know how your system is going to react. It will be a typo, so it might not be what it looks like. So worst case scenario, very worst case scenario, which I hope doesn't happen, is you'll have to actually type all this in by hand. And if you do, of course, you need to make sure and triple check that everything is correct, all the commas are correct, all the spaces are in place as they should be, and so on. So for example, here, netlab DC port UK, the entire domain does not have any spaces. But after LDAP admin, there is a space here between the comma and the DC. Alright, so be very careful to make sure that you have all the spaces and everything correct, because it's really difficult, really weird, and it won't take any wrong spaces or anything else. Once you do this, you need to edit the monitor LDIF file. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4 lines. All of this should be in one line. Of course, it will wrap the text around the text file depending on what editor you're using, and you don't need to worry about it. And all of that, including the none, must be in there. Okay. Again, you modify with LDAP modify and you add the monitor LDIF information to the server. And then you set up the LDAP database itself. In order to do this, you need to copy the sample database configuration file to varlib LDAP, and then you need to update the file permissions. So two distinct commands. The first command is copy user server open LDAP servers dbconfig example to varlib LDAP dbconfig. So you're copying and renaming at the same time, yes? And then the second command is to change the owner of that file of the directory varlib ldap to user ldap. You then need to add the ldap schemas, so you need to have cosine, nis, and inetogrgr person. Alright, you type all these should each come back with yes, completed successfully, okay. And then you need to add the base ldif. The base ldif is the base of the server, is what basically configures everything. So we have DC object class top domain, we have the LDAP manager, we have people that we want to add, and we have groups that we want to add as well. You add this with the LDAP add command, all of this. You will be asked for the LDAP admin password, which should be localhost 1. And the output should look something like this. So it's adding the new entry, the domain, the admin user, the people, and the group in there. So you can then create an LDAP user. So you can create an LD file. We can call it, for example, vas.ldif. All right. You can call it whatever you like, really, as long as you make sure that all the entries in here are correct. So you need the domain to be correct, you need the CN and UID to be correct, and you need the home folder to be what it needs to be as well. All right. This is a description of what the user is, and everything else should be as they are here. So you type the command LDAP add, you create, you know, it's an admin user in a domain netlab, and the user called VAS, and you add a password to it as well, so it can be whatever you want it to be, and that's it. So it has switches in this command, so minus S is specify the password, so I've chosen localhost 2, okay, for the user. It has minus X, which is username for which the password is changed, so that's that. And it has minus D, which is up here, which is distinguished name to authenticate to the LDAP server. We can then verify LDAP entries. So we added a new user. Let's see if it actually exists on our LDAP server. So we can copy and paste this command here. So it's searching for the user VAS in domain netlab report .uk. It's found it. It's there. VAS, it's an account. It has a home directory of this. The description is VAS, which is admin at netlab, and everything else. So this means that this has worked. So you have added successfully a user to your domain. You can then enable LDAP logging as well, which is always useful to have in case something goes wrong and you need to troubleshoot your server. And that's it for the server side of things. So everything that we've done so far, we've done in one terminal only, or two if you want to open a second terminal and keep the password there. And everything has been happening on the host. So now that we have created our server, we can go and configure our client and test our connection to the server. So, bottom right corner of the client VM, make sure you click on network card, choose NAT, wait for it to show up. So this is just to make sure that the virtual machine actually connects to the internet. So we need to make sure that we can type the command yum install minus y open LDAP clients and so on. As it was when we first started the virtual machine in host-only mode, it wouldn't have internet access because it would have a host-only connection from itself to the virtual machine that you call Prometheus. And then there will be another NATed connection from Prometheus to the outside world. So you cannot really go from host-only to NAT to the outside world. So if we temporarily change it to NAT, then shut down the network card, start it again, then it will get an IP address that we can actually use, and it will find the DNS server that your computer is using, that your VMware is using, and it can connect to the outside world. So the result of this should be that you should be able to ping the outside world. So all you need to do is you need to go to the virtual machine settings, choose NAT instead of host only, and then you need to go to your network cards up here, wired connected, wired settings. You can turn it off at this point, then go to IPv4, set it to automatic, apply, switch it off and on again, and then you should have a different IP address here, and you should be able to ping google.com essentially. Alright, once you have that, yum install minus y open LDAP clients and the PAM, it will install any other dependencies that it needs, and you should basically be able to have installed LDAP's client on the client, on Prometheus 0. Once that's done, you change your settings back to host only, you go to your network card, you set the IP address manually to whatever it is, whatever you want it to be, okay, and you ping Prometheus by name to make sure that you can actually contact your server by name. You then type this command, authconfig, enable LDAP, enable LDAP authentication. You're telling it that the server is Prometheus, you're telling it that the domain is netlab.uk, you enable the home directory for the user, and you update it. You then restart the LDAP client service, and that's it. Once this works, once this is done, you can verify that the LDAP is working, by verifying an LDAP login. So you can do get end pass wd pass. So get end pass wd username pass, and will tell you that yes, I know this guy, he's the admin at NetLab with a home directory of whatever, and every time he logs in he gets a pass terminal. Alright, so once you have this, it means that your client is simply configured to use your server and can identify the user that you've created, and that's it. You can, if you like, su vas, change it to the user, and the username will change. Alright. So with that done, as you can see, the client configuration, there's not much to it. I mean, the networking side of it will take more time to actually do, so that you can actually run the YAM command. It's just one command and one restart to get the service to run, to get the authentication server client to run, and then it works. So at this stage, you have configured the LDAP server, you've told the LDAP client to use it, and it can identify users and everything else. So essentially, this is the end of the labsheet. However, if you do want some extra marks, what I want you to be able to do is, you have a user, it generally works, but you cannot log in with it graphically as soon as you boot the client VM. Why? You need to figure it out, make it work, and document it for those extra marks of the labsheet. Okay, so if I actually logged out of this virtual machine, so, well, I can do it. User root, log out. So let's see what happens if I try to log into this as user VAS. All right, VAS, password is localhost 2. Yes, I recognize you. The last login was on Monday, whatever. Black screen. And that's it. So the last time I tried it, it just kicked me out back to the login screen. And of course, okay. So it will log in now because I did what was needed. So that's fine. Yes. But you need to figure out why it doesn't work straight from the beginning. Okay, it's a little thing, but I want you to document it, and I want you to write and say, you know, yes, you couldn't log in, I couldn't log in first time around until I did so and so. All right. Sorry, I didn't remember I had fixed this. So, this is LDAP. Okay, directory access protocol. So we have a server and a client. We need to configure all the little components of the server. I've tried to make the labsheet as bulletproof as possible. Okay, the only problem that you might have with it working is if you actually get any problem by copying and pasting the configuration files into the terminal or into your text editor. So just know if something doesn't work, the only thing that you can have to troubleshoot really, once your network's infrastructure is correct, is the actual characters that you are copying across and pasting into the file. All right. So this is the last labs for me. The week starting the 23rd of November is the last week that you have with me. However, of course, if you have any problems, any questions, you can ask me about it. I would suggest that you get LDAP and Kickstart, obviously, out of the way as soon as possible, because then the second half of the unit is with Dr. Linda Young, and she will give you some different tasks to do. So I'd rather you got all of this out of the way. Remember to finish your logbook on my side as well, okay? And then start working on Linda's, because she will be doing different things. You will forget about everything that you've done so far. In fact, if you do complete your my side of the logbook and you're happy with it, you can send me an email and you can tell me to have a look at it, right? And I can look at it and give you some feedback on whether it's good enough or whether you need to make any changes on it. And that will of course help you in the way that you need to do the rest of the logbook Linda's half as well, because the criteria for the logbook marking are of course the same. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.